Hello, hello. Can everyone hear me? All right. Do you have enough caffeine in you? Oh, God. That did sound like you don't have enough caffeine in you. Okay. Okay, I'm going to keep trying once again. Do you have enough energy in you?
Yes.
Better, slightly better. Okay, I'll deal with it. Okay. Okay. So, by the way, thank you, Burak, for the flattering introduction. By the way, Burak is also a founding member of the people who did structured streaming. So if you have any questions on structured streaming after this session, me as well as Burak, don't leave him alone. Okay, so before I start, let me take a quick consensus on how many people here, raise your hand, how many people here are familiar with structured streaming? Oh, quite a bit. How many people here actually use structured streaming in production? Less so. Okay, interesting. How many people here use Flink in production? Less, yes. Okay. Kidding aside. So I see that a bunch of you are familiar with structured streaming, but a bunch of you are not. So I have a shorter introduction on the basics of structured streaming in this deep dive, and I'll brush past them quickly so that everyone is roughly on the same page when I go into the more advanced meat of this talk about stateful stream processing. Okay, so starting with the very basic, what is structured streaming? It is a scalable stream processing engine, which is super fast because it's built on the core Spark SQL engine. It is fault tolerant, as with everything inside Spark. It has a rich unified API for you to express your streaming computation in a very easy manner, which deals with essentially complex data and complex workload, makes it dealing with them much easier. And it has a growing ecosystem of data sources and data sinks, which allows you to read and write streaming data as well as combine it with non-streaming data all in the same unified API in the same processing engine. So the basic philosophy of when we built structured streaming is that you as an end user writing your stream processing applications should not have to reason about streaming. Rather, you should just be expressing your query using a very simple batch-like API, and it's Spark's job to figure out how to exactly run that simple query on streaming data and how to continuously update the answer as new data comes in through the input data stream. And with that philosophy, we figured out the best abstraction to combine batch and streaming to make it unified is essentially tables. So batch data is essentially a bounded table, whereas streaming data is essentially like an unbounded table, where every record in the live stream is like a new row being appended to that table. So it's like an ever-growing table continuously being appended to. So therefore, it's an unbounded table. But with this common abstraction of that unifies batch and streaming data, that makes essentially expressing your computation much easier. And to walk through a concrete example, let's try something like this. So let's say you want to write a streaming query that does the following. It, one, reads the JSON data from Kafka. It wants to parse the JSON data, clean it up, maybe, and handle JSON errors and stuff. Store it in a more structured format, like a Parquet table, so that you can interactively query that data much more easily, as opposed to reading from Kafka. And you want to get end-to-end failure guarantees. To do this, all you have to do is the following. One, step one would be specify Spark how to read the data from Kafka. Now, for that, you have to say that your data is in Kafka. Kafka has these bootstrap servers. You have to specify them as options. You want to tell Spark that what is the topic to read from, and finally load. And what this produces is essentially a Spark data frame. So how many here are not familiar with what Spark data frame is? Okay, that makes my job easier. So in this case, Spark data frame, what it will generate for the Kafka data source is a data frame with the following columns: keys, values, topic, from which each record came from, the partition and the offset of that record, and as well as the timestamp on when it entered Kafka. Basically, all the information that you get from a Kafka consumer, you will get them in a tabular format. So Now, with this data frame, now you can do any kind of data frame processing. For example, what we want to do here is, first of all, take the binary values and cast it as a UTF-8 string, now which basically has the JSON. Then there is other built-in operations like from JSON, where you essentially wants to parse out the JSON string into a predefined schema and convert it to a more structured format. And then finally, after doing this, all these transformations on the data frame, you want to write it out as a parquet table. So you just say write stream and the parquet format, give it the path where you want to create the table. And then as a final step, before you actually start the query, you can specify how do you want to run it. Do you want to run it in 1 second trigger intervals or 1 minute trigger intervals? Also, you want fault tolerance. So you have to specify the checkpoint location where the streaming query will save all the necessary information to handle and recover from failures. Again, I'll go into the details in the rest of my talk, but here is a high-level idea of what a streaming query looks like at a high level. And then finally, obviously, you call start. And when you call start, what happens underneath is that Spark converts this data frame code into a logical plan, which is an abstract representation of what does this query want to do. Like, it wants to do some projection, it wants to do some filtering, or if it wants to do some additional analysis, exploding, et cetera. And then from that logical plan, Spark SQL does all its optimizer magic to convert it to a much more optimized plan. And from that optimized plan, it actually generates a series of execution plans, which runs on new batches of data. So this is essentially the micro-batch processing in structured streaming, where given the query, it converts it to a very optimized logical plan, from which it keeps generating a continuous series of execution plans, which keeps processing batches of new data as new data becomes available in Kafka. So essentially, Spark SQL converts this batch-like query into a series of incremental queries, and you don't need to bother about how it is doing underneath. You just need to write that batch-like query, and Spark takes care of the rest. Another thing Spark takes care of implicitly is it tracks what offsets has been read from Kafka and stores it in the checkpoint location you have provided in a write-ahead log. So if there is any kind of failure, it can read those checkpointed offsets and figure out where it needs to restart it once again. For people who have actually used D streams, it also had this checkpointing mechanism, except there were problems with using checkpoints in D streams because you could not change the code, et cetera. We have actually learned from those mistakes that I did in grad school and fixed the checkpointing mechanism in structured streaming and in a much better way. So you can actually change your query within some constraints and actually maybe add a filter because you found some corrupted data, you want to filter out the corrupted data, et cetera. You can add those filters and restart your query from where it left off, from the checkpoint location. So this is a much better checkpoint recovery solution than what people may have seen in Spark streaming and D streams. Anyway, so when this query is running in the background, what's happening is that the JSON stream of data from Kafka becomes converted to a parquet table within seconds, minutes, and so you can start querying your latest up to the last minute or so data interactively very fast. And structured streaming, because it's built on the super optimized SQL engine, can do this very fast. So if you're comparing raw throughput performance, we've showed in our benchmarks that well, this is a little dated last year, so things may have changed, we may have improved, they may have improved, but roughly speaking, we were at that point 2x faster than Flink, and which means that for running your streaming ETL query, it'll be 2x cheaper for you to process all your data. So that was hopefully a decent enough overview of the basics. And if you want to learn more about basics, really understand the query that I shared in more detail, I have a previous Spark Summit talk about, which is a deep dive into the basics of structured streaming. Here, I'm going to start off with the main focus of my talk here, which is the stateful stream processing. Now, just to understand what is stateful, let's first understand what is stateless stream processing. So Stateless stream processing is basically where every record can be processed to generate the answer independent of any other record. So there is basically no information sharing across the records in the input stream. For example, if you just want to, similar to the previous query, if you just want to like do a select project and a filter, then it doesn't matter what other records are while processing a single record. Now, so therefore, it doesn't need to remember any information across multiple records. Whereas a stateful, on the other hand, needs to combine information across multiple records. Therefore, it needs to remember as state what some information from the previous records. For example, if you want to do basically a grouped count or a count of the number of records you have generated after filtering, then basically the running count is essentially the state that it has to keep in memory in a fault-tolerant manner so that if there is any failure, it remembers what the last record processed and what was the count at that point of time. So this is a stateful streaming query. Now, the way this is managed is in the microbatch model that structured streaming runs, the state is essentially versioned. And after each microbatch has been processed, the new updated state is essentially saved. That particular version of the state is saved. And the next microbatch reads from that exactly the expected version of that state to create the next version of the state. So since it's versioned and it's all the processing is deterministic, it end-to-end guarantees that even if there is any kind of failure, it will recover both the right offset of data to reprocess as well as the corresponding right version of the state to reapply the updates again. So together, it essentially gives you the same exactly once end-to-end guarantee for as you get for stateless stream processing. And this state is essentially saved in the same checkpoint location that you have provided. It's saved over there. So and this all of this happens underneath. All you need to do is specify that checkpoint location. In terms of actual execution, the state is actually kept distributed in the Spark executor memory. So in the microbatch model, every microbatch, there is a bunch of tasks that is executing the new data. So these tasks running on the executors read the right version of the state, update and create the new version, all in a completely distributed manner, also while being backed by the checkpoint location specified in HDFS or S3 or Azure Blob Store. So that's the general idea of how state works and how it's executed inside structured streaming. Let's move a bit higher and to see that as an end user, you can use the state in the form of stateful operations in the DataFrame API. So there's a general philosophy that we have for how stateful operations work. So there are essentially two broad classes of stateful operations. There's the operations where the state cleanup is automatic. You don't need to really worry about it. And then there's another class of stateful operations where you can customize and define how exactly the state will be cleaned up. So in the first class of operations are the standard SQL operations like count, the example that I gave. And there are other variations that I'm going to talk about where the semantics of that operation is very clear. It's standard SQL semantics. And so the system, the engine underneath, knows exactly how to clean up stuff because it knows exactly what the semantics are. Whereas in the other category are these operations where you want to really customize what your operation does. You want to have very custom semantics on what it does, et cetera. So that leads to a very customized operation that has the full power of low-level control on what you want to do with the state, when do you want to clean up, how do you want to manipulate it. So in this talk, I'm going to talk about these operations. In the first category, there is aggregations, deduplications, and stream-stream joins. And in the second category is mapGroupsWithState, which is going to be the arbitrary stateful operation that we have in structured streaming. So in the rest of this talk, I'll go as We'll talk about these built-in operations. I'm going to talk about watermarks to how to really control the amount of state these built-in operations keep. Again, then I'm going to talk about that arbitrary stateful operation, and finally, how to monitor and debug these stateful queries in your streaming gig application. So here we go. So first step is a streaming aggregation. It's the most simple stateful operation that you have. You can do count on the, of the number of, not just count of the total number of keys, but also grouped counts. You can do grouped counts over time windows using event time. And here, you can express windows in very simple SQL functions like window, where you specify window, the timestamp in the data itself, which is essentially the event time, and your window duration, window length, 10 minutes in this particular example. But you can specify both the window length as well as the sliding interval, how frequently does the window move. And then you can also do other kind of aggregations like average. There are built-in other aggregations, as well as there are you can write your own user-defined aggregations. So you can also aggregate by both time as well as key and stuff. Now, underneath what happens is that the engine keeps track of these event time. Let's say we are doing event time window-based aggregation. So each window is like a grouping bucket. And the engine essentially, which wants to maintain the count based on these buckets, essentially keeps opening these new buckets as new windows appear. Like for example, if you're doing, in this example, I don't know if it's visible from the back or not, but this is doing a 1 hour windows. So as it keeps seeing new data with new event time, it'll keep opening these 1 hour buckets and keep incrementing the count as records, because it sees new records. And this mechanism automatically handles late data, which is a pretty common case in when you're handling real world streaming data. You may receive some records that are more than 1 hour old or more than 2 hours old. And in this case, since it has the buckets are made and already open, it's just simply about incrementing the right bucket. Not the latest bucket, but the maybe a 2 hour older bucket. So this mechanism automatically handles late data. But the side effect of that is the engine does not know when these buckets can be closed. So essentially, it will, without any further information, it will keep opening these 1 hour buckets ad infinitum, because it doesn't have the additional semantics that is to know when a particularly old bucket is not going to get any more updates. For example, a 1 hour bucket that is 7 days old is probably not going to get any new data. So it could actually remove that bucket and therefore reduce the memory consumption of the state. But the engine, by default, it doesn't know that additional semantics. For that, we provided this mechanism called watermarks. And watermark is essentially like a moving threshold of how late data is expected to be. And so based on that, the engine can figure out when to drop old state. For example, it is defined based on the max event time the engine has seen at any point of time. So let's say you know that your data will be at max 10 minutes late. So then you define watermark to be 10 minutes behind the max event time. So as the new data comes in with newer and newer event time, the engine itself will figure out what is the watermark, which is 10 minutes minus the max event time minus the 10 minutes. And any data or any state that is older than the 10 minutes, it will automatically figure out how to clean that up. Now, this 10 minutes is essentially the watermark delay. Now, this 10 minutes essentially allows you to control how much late data you're willing to accept. So if, let's say, there is some record that is 5 minutes late, and you're doing some sort of aggregation, let's say a count, then the 5 minute late data point would be allowed to aggregate because it's less than 10 minutes, because you've said I'm willing to accept 10 minute late data up to 10 minutes. But if there is a record that is more than 10 minutes late, let's say 15 minutes, then the engine will automatically drop that data and say that, okay, I'm not going to accept this much late data because I've already cleaned up the state associated with anything older than 10 minutes. Programmatically, all you need to do is essentially call this method called with watermark. and to specify the timestamp in the record and the watermark delay at 10 minutes. By the way, this is an operation that actually only makes sense in the streaming context. So what happens if you apply it on a batch data frame? This with watermark just simply gets ignored when you're running it on batch data. So you can write this query with a watermark defined in the query itself and run it on both batch, in which case the watermark will be silently ignored. Or you can run it on streaming data where the watermark is going to be used for doing the state cleanup. So this operation is simply ignored in the batch data. But in the streaming case, when this query is actually run, the system will automatically figure out what is the latest event time at any point of time. So for example, if the x-axis is the wall clock processing time in this diagram, and the y-axis is the event time, as you can see, as you move to the right, data with newer and newer event time in the y-axis keeps coming in, and the engine will automatically figure out what is the max of the data that has come in, and based on the 10 minutes, it will define the watermark. And as it keeps going forward and receiving new data, if there is data that is late but still newer than the watermark, it will allow it to be aggregated to the count. But if there's a record which is older than the watermark, it will drop it because it has already cleaned up any windows that is more than 10 minutes old. So with this watermark delay, essentially you have a clear trade-off between how late data you want to tolerate and the size of the state. So if you essentially want to give less memory to the state, then you can tolerate less late data. But if you have to tolerate for your business purposes a lot more late data, like let's say 2 days, 3 days, 7 days, then you have to give the query, the Spark cluster, more memory for it to keep all the necessary state over last 7 days. Now, the other thing to notice here is that in terms of the query semantics, there's a clear separation of concerns between all these different times that I've specified till now. So for example, if you have a query where you have defined a watermark with 10 minutes, you have defined a grouping on the window of 5 minutes, and also you have said a trigger interval of 10 seconds, each of these times have different semantics with respect to the result of the query. So one is a query semantic which defines exactly what you get as the result. And so the window of the group by defines the query semantics that you will get an output with 5 minute windows. Now this query semantics is same whether you run it on batch data or streaming data. So this query semantics is integral part of what the query does. On the other hand, there is the processing details on at the time of processing as a streaming query, how do you want to control the processing level, the engine level details of memory consumption and stuff. So with watermark is essentially a processing level detail which defines how much late data to keep and when to drop data if it's too late and stuff. And also the trigger interval is also another processing level detail on to how frequently to generate new results whenever there is new data. Now it's important to understand that the processing details does not really affect the result of your query. So it's the query semantics, the group by window, that affects what the result of your query is going to be. And the processing level detail is also tied only when you're processing that query as a stream. And these details are completely ignored when you're running it on a batch. So it's important to understand this clear separation of the query semantics and the processing details. Okay, that's all about streaming aggregation. The next operation that I'm going to talk about is streaming deduplication, where it's pretty simple. You have data coming in where at the source it may generate duplicate data. And you can identify duplicate data by some unique record identifier. That is needed to really identify whether a data is duplicate or not. So all you need to do in data frame is say the data frame with duplicate data dot drop duplicates based on that unique record ID. And what internally Spark SQL will do is basically will keep the state of all the records that it has, all the unique records that it has seen, all the record by their record unifiers. And whenever there's a new record, it will check whether this record has already been seen or not, and based on that, whether it will just silent, it will drop that record or not. So what comes out is a data frame which contains only unique record and unique records. Again, if you let it run continuously, you're never going to throw any past record because it never in this particular query it doesn't know when it can stop storing all the past records, so it'll never clean up state. So for that, you have to specify again the watermark. So you have to say the with watermark on the particular timestamp column, and you have to define the drop duplicate on that timestamp column. So basically, if this works with the assumption that the record that you're generating, the duplicate record will have the same record identifier as well as the same timestamp of where it was when it was generated. So when that is true, then you can just say drop duplicate by both the record ID and the timestamp, as well as specify the watermark on that timestamp column. And the system will automatically figure out that, if a record is more than, let's say, 1 hour old, if that is a watermark delay, then it's not going to see any more duplicate records for that, because things cannot be more than 1 hour late. That's the assumption. And so accordingly, it will figure out how to clean up the state and therefore keep the state bounded. So this happens kind of seamlessly. Anyway, so the next I'm going to talk about stream joins and the arbitrary stateful operations, but I think it's getting very close to the 30-minute mark. So rather than I start off this new section, I think maybe there are probably 3 minutes left, so time. If there is any question, I'm happy to answer for the next 3-4 minutes, but there will also be time for answering questions at the end of the second part of this talk. Yes.
Right. Let me just.
So why do you need the timestamp on the second argument? Like, I understand why do you need it in the first one, like the watermark. But why do you need it in the distinct dedup? And what happens if a timestamp is not unique for each unique record?
So we need the timestamp in the drop duplicate because basically in the state, the old records and the unique IDs needs to be indexed with the timestamp. Only then can it use the watermark to filter out the records that are really old and will not get any further duplicates. If it's not indexed by the timestamp, then it doesn't know how to define which record is old versus which record is new. That's why it needs a timestamp, and that timestamp has to be unique, with same kind of unique as the unique record identifier.
Is the state store pluggable, or you have a fixed state store implementation?
Sorry.
So basically, state store where you keep all the state. Let's say you keep it in memory and then kind of put it into HDFS. So Flink provides a lot of implementation of state store. So
that's a very good question. So the state store is pluggable, though the API is not final and public. So by default, in the Apache Spark version, we store it in the memory, though there has been improvements made in the Spark 2.4 release on on the memory consumption of that. In Databricks runtime, and this is putting my Databricks hat on, we have a RocksDB implementation of that state store, which is a far more optimized implementation with lower memory usage that scales to millions and millions of hundreds of millions of keys per executor. So we have the more optimized implement available as part of Databricks runtime.
Hi, what happens in case of failures to the watermarks? Because if a job fails, right, and you have set your watermarks to 10 minutes, when the job comes back maybe after an hour, what would happen? I mean, would it?
Good question. So the watermark is also saved as part of the checkpoint location. And now if you come back after 1 hour, you will start processing from the 1 hour back point of view. So you will be seeing data that is 1 hour old. Now the watermark proceeds only when you see newer data. It's only, so it proceeds at the rate at which you see new data and new event time. So it will still be consistent because it will just be 1 hour delayed from the wall clock time, but it'll be consistent with the data that is being processed right now, which may be just 1 hour older data compared to the wall clock time, but it, the data and the watermark itself will be consistent with each other.
Yes. Usually, like in stream processing engines, we have different types of windows, like count-based windows. So currently, in Spark structured streaming, only time-based windows is supported, right?
Yes. In Spark structured streaming, only time-based windows are supported because it has very clear SQL semantics. With count-based windows, it is trickier to support because count-based windows automatically assume ordering of the data. And SQL semantics operations doesn't really have a define ordered data unless you actually call order by. So it gets complicated to really support that. And we don't see much demand for that in practice. Two, for cases where you do want count-based windows, there you want to actually control the ordering in which you see those records, and that's when the hammer for all stateful operations, map group with state, that I'm going to talk about in the next part of my talk. There you have the full control on doing your own custom windowing where you can control the order and stuff.
All right, let's give a 5-minute break, and then we're going to continue with part 2.